In the last video, we talked about when a function is continuous at a point. Now we're going to talk about intervals where functions are continuous and which functions tend to be continuous. So here's a summary of what we had from last time. A function is continuous if the limit of the function as x approaches a from below, the limit of the function as x approaches from a from above, and the value of the function at x equals a all exist and they all agree. Now here are a couple pictures of situations where they don't quite agree. Here the value agrees with the limit from the left. Here the value agrees with the limit from the right. In those situations we say that this is continuous to the left. Some people say continuous from the left. Some people say continuous on the left. They all mean the same thing. And here we say it's continuous on the right. Now, in general, it's continuous, period, if whenever x is close to a, f of x is close to f of a. Because if x is close to a, it means either x is slightly less than a, slightly bigger than a, or equal to a. And in all those situations, since the limits agree with the value of the function, f of x is close to f of a. So another way to think about continuity is if changing the value of the function slightly if changing the value of x slightly only changes the value of the function slightly, that means it's continuous. Continuous on the right means if increasing x slightly only changes the value of the function slightly, and you don't worry about what's happening on the left. Continuous on the left if decreasing x slightly doesn't change it much, and you don't worry about what happens on the other side. Okay. So now we're ready for our definitions of intervals of convergence. A function is continuous on an interval I if it's continuous at each point in that interval with up to two exceptions. The two exceptions are the endpoints. We have a closed interval, that is, if we include the endpoints, then at the left endpoint, we can't talk about what happens when x is less than alpha because that's not in our interval. We only care about what's happening when x is bigger or equal to alpha, so we actually only need right continuity at alpha. At beta, we are only interested in the left continuity because there are no values of x bigger than beta in this interval. So once we restrict our attention to this interval, we care about two-sided continuity in the middle, right continuity at alpha, left continuity at beta. Now let's look at some examples. The function f of x equals x squared is continuous on the entire real line. Because no matter what value of x you take, if you add a tiny bit to x or take away a tiny bit to x, you don't change x squared very much. 2.01 squared is very close to 2 squared, and 1.99 squared is very close to 2 squared. And negative 3.01 squared is very close to negative 3 squared. You can draw the whole graph without picking up your pencil. It's continuous. Now, you've also seen the graphs of sine of x. It just goes up and down and up and down. You can draw it without picking up your pencil. The graph of cosine of x looks pretty much the same. You've seen the graph of e to the x. All of these are continuous. And all polynomials are continuous. And I'll explain the reason in a later video. Now we know more functions than just sine, cosine, and polynomials and exponentials. We know logs. The log function isn't continuous on the whole real line because it's not defined on the whole real line. You can't take the log of zero. You can't take the log of a negative number. But you can take the log of a positive number, and whenever for all positive values of x, the log varies continuously. About square root of x. It's defined for all non-negative numbers, and its graph looks like this. And I claim it's continuous for all non-negative numbers, and here's where we needed the special exception for endpoints. There is no limit of square root of x as you approach from the left, but that's okay because we're only looking at the left endpoint. So we only compare the value here to the value when x is slightly bigger than 0, and they line up smoothly. This is a perfectly continuous function because it's continuous to the right at x equals 0, and it's continuous at both sides for all other values of x. Finally, we can consider ratios. If you've got two functions, f and g, the ratio is going to be continuous except where the denominator is 0, because if you change x a little bit, you only change f a little bit, you only change g a little bit, you only change the ratio a little bit. So where is this rational function continuous? Well, we first have to see where is it defined. Where is the denominator non-zero? So if you factor the top and the bottom, you see the denominator is 0 at 5 and at 3. So those are points where the function doesn't exist, certainly can't be continuous. Everywhere else, we can cancel the factor of x minus 5 from the top and the bottom. And so we get that the function is this, except at 5 and 3. The function doesn't exist at 5 and 3. It's continuous everywhere except at 5 and at 3.